Ramanujan for G is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
So in today's class, we will be studying about valence bond theory, and we know what is a covalent bond, how it forms because of the sharing of electrons, and we also know what is a single bond, double bond, or triple bond, lone pairs. What are the lone pairs? Means bonded pair, shared pair of electrons, and lone pairs that we also know. These are all because of the Lewis theory that we have studied. But what we do not know about the covalent bonds that we cannot determine using Lewis theory is the shape of the molecules. And it is that we know that Lewis approach helps in writing the structure of molecules that we have seen, but it fails to explain the formation of chemical bonds. That is one of the drawback of the Lewis theory. And another drawback is we cannot determine shape based on the Lewis dot structures that according to him, whatever the way he has proposed. If you go to write a Lewis dot structure, we'll find all the molecules are flat and they are planar. But we do not see it experimentally. We find that different molecules have different definite shapes. So how those molecules attain certain definite shapes? That's the question that we need to understand, we need to answer. For that, different theory came. And those one of the examples that I have said that the Lewis theory explains the formation of covalent bonds, that means if we know there is a single bond between two hydrogen atoms in hydrogen molecule, and the same single bond is between this fluorine and fluorine atoms in F2. And because of this single bond formation, means sharing of one electrons, both the molecules, they attain their octet. All the atoms in both the molecules attain their octet. But in such a case, both the bonds should be of the equal strength, but we do not get it. Because if the octet formation, and based on that is the main thing of the Lewis dot structure, writing Lewis structure, is the completion of the octet. If that is the main criteria, major criteria, we should have get equal bond strength for both F2 and H2. But we do not get it. Not only this, we also do not get this bond length. Bond lengths are different. In the case of hydrogen, it is 74 picometer, and in case of fluorine, it is 144 picometer. Why it is so? And the energy, you can see the hydrogen bond H2H2, the bond energy is 435.8 kilojoule per mole. But in case of fluorine, it is 155 kilojoule per mole. So why it's so? Some other theory came, like VSEPR theory. We know valence shell electron pair repulsion theory. This theory explains based on the Lewis dot structure and bonded pairs and the lone pairs, that there is a repulsion between these different pairs that are found in the valence shell. And because of those repulsion, molecule gets some arrangement where the repulsion is minimized. So there will be less tension in different bonds, and so the molecule will attain lowest energy geometry. That is one thing about the VSEPR theory that we will study later on. I have not taught it because I am thinking to merge this valence bond theory and VSEPR theory for you to solve the problems like that. How will you find the shape of molecules? Because if you merge this with the hybridization, you will understand. It will be helpful for you to remember the shape of molecules, or to find out the shape of the molecules. That's why I have not taught. But the valence shell electron pair repulsion theory, just the basic gist, I am saying that electron domains. I am explaining in terms of domains. In your books, you might not see the domains. There is a lone pair domain and there is a bond pair domain. So bond pair domain is a smaller. See, if it is a single bond pair domain, then a smaller. It's a shape size is a smaller than the lone pair domain. Lone pair domain, you can see it's a bigger in size. So if it's bigger in size, it will take larger space, and because of the larger space and bond pair, this domain take a smaller size, so it is a smaller in size, so there will be repulsion. So because of this repulsion, or even the size of the domain, we'll find that the bond lone pairs are farther than these two bond pairs. I mean, the distance between lone pair and bond pair will be smaller than lone pair because of you just you can understand in terms of the size of the these domains. It is this the BACPR says that the lone pair interaction dominates over lone pair bond pair interactions, and lone pair bond pair interaction dominates over bond pair interaction is repulsion, and that is why you find different molecules, different distortion, other things that we will see in details later on. So, but the basic problem with the VACPR theory is we cannot explain it theoretically. It doesn't have a theoretical basis, because the valence bond theory, all the theory that you explain later on, they are based on the very solid foundation of quantum chemical theories. Like, you know, so to overcome this theory, means Lewis theory of covalent bonding and the VACPR theory, to overcome with this flaws in this theory, people came with two theory, that is valence bond theory and molecular orbital theory. They are based on the quantum mechanical principles. You know quantum mechanics a bit, you know, slight name, like in the atomic structure we have introduced, it is mostly we starts with the Schrodinger equation, that is known to you at least. H psi is equal to E psi. That's the basic principle, that's the master equation in quantum theory. And different thing, this is very difficult for you to understand right now. We will understand this theory in the qualitative terms, not in the terms of mathematical, detailed mathematical equations. So valence bond theory was introduced by Hitler and London. It was introduced in 1927, and this was the theory. 1926, Schrodinger gave the equation, Schrodinger equation. It was the beginning of quantum physics, and later on the quantum chemistry. So, and further developed by Pauling and others, the valence bond theory is based on the knowledge of electronic configuration of elements. That's the one thing. Electronic configuration, we know how to find out of different electronic configuration of different elements, and the overlap criteria of atomic orbitals. We know that even the atomic orbitals, they comes from the solution of the hydrogen atom. That solution is Schrodinger equation. You solve Schrodinger equation, you will get these orbitals. Concept of orbitals is again the quantum mechanical, comes from quantum mechanical theory. The hybridization of atomic orbitals, these are all based on the quantum mechanical principle and principle of variations and superposition. Superposition, you know, in the wave theory, you will understand what how the different waves impose a superposition. That's the thing we'll see. Interference and all these kind of things you will study there. So valence bond theory in a qualitative and non-mathematical way only, this is in your syllabus, can be understood by considering the formation of hydrogen molecule. Hydrogen molecule, just a simplest example will take at first. And you know, the simplest means hydrogen molecule, one hydrogen has only one nucleus, means one proton and one electron. It's the simplest molecule all the known molecules. It's the simplest one. So we can consider two hydrogen atoms, hydrogen atom A and B, to recognize. In reality, we cannot recognize, but to understand the concept, we can just tell that this molecule, hydrogen atom is A and this hydrogen atom is B. So similarly, the nucleus of hydrogen atom A is, we can represent it as a Na. N means nucleus and A means of atom A, and Nb, nucleus of atom B, as Nb. And similarly, the electrons Ea and Eb, electrons of atom A as Ea and atom B as Eb. And so this is the arrangement. When you can see the hydrogen atom B, this is B, and hydrogen atom A, this one, and its electron is here of B, and electron of A is here, and this is the nucleus, this is Na, this is Nb. What happens when these two atoms are at infinite distance or very at a very large separation? What you will find, there will be no interaction between two atoms. So obvious, one can simply visualize it. There will be no interaction if they are at infinite or very large distance. But once you start bringing them closer, and closer at after a certain distance, certain finite distance, two different kind of forces starts operating. One is the attractive force and another is the repulsive force. This is one thing, how attractive and repulsive, we know the electrostatic interactions. What will be, there will be opposite charge, there will be attraction, if there is a bit attraction between opposite charges, and if there are same charge, same nature of charge, there will be repulsion. So when these two atoms come closer at a certain finite distance, so the two attractive forces will start operating. This will be that these forces Na and Ea, in the nucleus of A and electron of A, these are already there because these are the intra-atomic interaction. This Nb and Eb was already there. What is the new force that starts operating after bringing these atoms closer is the nucleus of one atom and electron of other atoms. This nucleus of A will have attract electrons of B. So Na and Eb, attractive interaction, then similarly the nucleus of B will feel attraction because of the electrons in the electron in the A, Ea. So these are two attractive forces. Similarly, two different repulsive forces will start operating, and this repulsive forces will be repulsion between electron of A and electron of B. The nuclei of A and nuclei of B will also repel each other because they are both positively charged. So attractive forces tend to bring two molecules close to each other, whereas the repulsive forces tend to push them apart. This we know, it's very simple to understand. Attraction will bring two molecules, two atoms, two entities closer, and repulsion will push them apart. What is now to be noted here is at larger distances, when the separation between these two are larger, it doesn't mean larger means infinitely large. At certain finite distance, though it is larger, separation is larger, the attractive forces dominates over repulsive forces. This is what people have found experimentally. So attraction is larger than repulsion. So these two atoms will start coming closer, and this is how we can see here at a very large distance. Even these two hydrogen atoms are at very large distance, there is no interaction. Once they comes to a certain finite distance, suppose here, and then bringing them closer and closer, some attraction and repulsion starts operating. Attraction is dominating over repulsion. So these two atoms are coming closer. How? This is the bond length, the interatomic distance, internuclear distance, it is on the x-axis, you can see. And this is the energy. So the attraction is increasing. Attraction means potential energy of the system will decrease. We know this. Once attraction is there, the potential energy will decrease. So the energy of the system is going down, coming here at certain finite distance now here. This is called equilibrium distance. The repulsion and attraction, they become balanced by each other. They balance each other. And that's why this position is called equilibrium position. And the distance at which we achieve this equilibrium position is called the bond length. This is the bond length. So bond length, this is 74 picometer for hydrogen. If you come closer to this, that you see the repulsive forces will start operating, the repulsion will be larger and the attraction is still there, but repulsion will dominate over attraction. So this molecule will send here this. And if you go this side, if you increase the distance, attraction will dominate over repulsion. So molecule will come here. So that is why molecule vibrates here, or something like, you know, all the bonds vibrate. So simply I'm telling that this is the equilibrium position. At this position, these two atoms are said to be bonded. Bonded means that there is this bonding brings stability to the entire system is the hydrogen molecule. And this is because the energy is released during this the formation of the bond, because attraction is dominating over repulsion. The potential energy is decreasing, that energy released from here to here in this entire process. That means the energy was zero here. You see at the larger distance, the energy zero. Once you come down this scale, this -435, minus depicts means the attraction energy is released. This is a thermodynamic sign. If the energy is released, it is shown with the negative sign, the enthalpy. So the energy so released is called bond enthalpy. Bond enthalpy, if you want to break this bond, means separate those two hydrogen atoms. So we will have to provide this energy, this much energy. So this much from minus 435.8 to zero you are going, means plus 435.8 energy you will have to provide to this molecule to separate two hydrogen atoms apart to an infinite distance. And that is what this energy is. And this is where we show it. The H2 gaseous plus this bond enthalpy and hydrogen gas, and these are hydrogen atoms to separate them apart. This is one thing. This is how the valence bond theory, the concept has come. At further distance, the attraction will dominate over the repulsion. So these atoms will come closer. This is true for all the bonds, even for the CH bond, O bond, OH bonds, all kind of bonds that you can see, that there were, even it is a diatomic or polyatomic. The only thing is, in diatomic molecules, it is easier to understand because there is only one bond and two atoms. In the polyatomic molecules, the things are much complicated. To understand further things, the concept of orbital was given. The concept of orbital means what? The when you are bringing these two atoms closer, they come so closer to each other that their valence shell merge with each other. Partially merging of this valence shell, that is called also as a overlap of orbitals, because electrons are there in different orbitals that we know. And when different orbitals, the valence shell orbital that are at the farthest distance from the nucleus, so they will first come to interact with each other. When they are much closer, they will start merging. They will start overlapping with each other. So this partial merging that we know. So I'll just read out this again. At equilibrium position, two bonded atoms are so near that their atomic orbitals undergo partial interpenetration. Interpenetration, you understand. One penetrates into the other. This partial merging or interpenetration of atomic orbitals is called overlapping of atomic orbitals. This partial merging means the formation of the bond, covalent bond, is accompanied by pairing of unpaired electrons present in the valence shell of approaching atoms. Two atoms are approaching in the valence shell, and this, when they are coming closer, the electrons in those valence shell of two different atoms, they will pair up. And then pair up means whenever they will be pair up, their spin will be always opposite. This is, you know, Hund's rule. Because of the Pauli exclusion principle that comes, because if you, these two electrons will come with the same spin, there all the four quantum numbers will be the same. So it will come with the opposite spin only, to also to minimize the repulsion between two electrons, and all the correlation, all those kind of concepts are not there in your syllabus. That's the partial merging that we know. The extent of I'm telling, the two electrons with unpaired spin means one spin, they'll come closer in the different valence shell, closer the overlap will occur, and with overlap the pairing of these two electrons occurs. They will come such a closer that they are kind of in one orbital. It appears that they are in the same orbitals, and same orbitals that is because of the bond formation. Bond formation, two orbitals of two atoms, they merge with each other, so they form one single large orbital, that you can understand. And that two orbitals became one large orbital, so two electrons are in the same orbital, so they will be in the with the opposite spin. The extent of overlap decides the strength of a covalent bond. This is a very important thing. If the overlap is greater, the covalent bond will be stronger. Overlap is weaker, bond will be weaker. Now the question comes, is the direction, how will you, because of this, how will you tell the directional properties or explain the directional properties of covalent bonds? That what we know is that according to valence bond theory, the covalent bond is formed by overlapping of atomic orbitals. That is, means the molecule of hydrogen is formed due to the overlap of 1s orbitals of two hydrogen atoms. We know that hydrogen atom has only 1s orbital, doesn't have any orbital. It cannot have, because its principal quantum number is 1 with 1, L will only be 0. L is only 0 means it will have only s orbital. So these two 1s orbitals will overlap, so hydrogen molecule will be formed. Well, how such covalent bond forms in polyatomic molecules? This is the question that simply we understood with for the hydrogen atom, that is okay, but in the polyatomic molecules, explaining this is a bit difficult, but it is not impossible to explain them. So we have theories to explain those bonds, so that they so the question that is coming here now is, why is so that CH4 molecule has tetrahedral geometry? Tetrahedral, you know, I have explained it, a tetrahedral geometry, that two with the HCH bond angle of 109.5 degree, perfectly all the HCH bond angle is 109.5 degree, and in the why the shape of ammonia is pyramidal and that of hydrogen is bent. These are the questions that we have not answered till now based on the valence bond theory. So there we will come with the concept of hybridization, overlap and hybridization of atomic orbitals, and these concepts are included here in the valence bond theory. The hybridization, the concept that we have seen, it was given by the Pauling, we'll see later. So overlapping, let us first understand overlapping of atomic orbitals. Overlapping, how does the overlap helps in bond formation, and what are different kind of overlaps, that we will see first. These are the examples here. These are two examples which are called the zero overlap. Just a minute, my cursor is not coming. So here, this is zero overlap. So means if two atoms are coming closer, you need two things to happen to have overlap between different orbitals. One thing is orientation of orbitals should be right. If they are coming with different orientation, there might not be overlap. And another thing is electrons, imagine electrons as a wave. So if these waves, they will come with the opposite sign, they'll come in opposite phase, that overlap will not have any a favorable impact, favorable effect. If they'll come with the same phase, then only this kind of interference and that overlap will be favorable. So two things are very important. If these two orbitals are coming and the electrons are coming, orbitals, electrons, and that is two as a wave, you can understand, they should be in the same phase with the same sign. Phase means sign, plus minus we can show, and the orientation should also be right. In this case, you see the phase is right, plus is plus, minus is with minus, but the orientation is not right. And because of that orientation, there is no overlap here. So this is called zero overlap. The s orbital and p orbitals, if they come with each other along this certain internuclear axis, you will find that this there will be along the node of this p orbital, there will be almost zero overlap. There is a negligible overlap between these two orbitals, s and p orbitals. So there will be no bond formation here. But in case if we see here, if these two orbitals, s and p orbitals that we saw just now, if I just rotate this p orbitals orbital in the clockwise fashion, what will I'll come with this orientation. With this orientation, what you know, that they are in the same phase and with the right orientation, so there will be covalent bond formation. If that orbital is, this one is rotated in the anti-clockwise fashion, what will come with this orientation? Though their orientation is right, their phase is not right, so there will be no bond formation here. Similarly, this is out of phase or the negative phase overlap, so there will no covalent bond formation. There is again here plus minus, you see out of phase overlap, there is no covalent bond formation. This is also no bond formation, out of phase overlap. These are in phase overlap and with right orientation, you see there are covalent bond formation in all these cases. And in this case, what we saw was these two cases, though the phase was right, but the orientation was not right. So there is no covalent bond formation happens in such cases. So orbitals forming bonds should have same sign and orientation in a space, same sign and same orientation in a space. This is called positive overlap. The criteria of overlap as the main factor for the formation of covalent bonds applies uniformly to all the covalent bonded molecules. Covalent is homonuclear, heteronuclear, diatomic, polyatomic, everything. This concept is there. Now the thing is, now we know that because of atomic orbitals, covalent bond forms. So let us try to explain the shape and all the bond angles of polyatomic molecules in terms of atomic orbital overlap. Let us first we'll take the example of CH4, like how the orbital overlap concept helps to understand the geometry of polyatomic molecules. This is the question that we are going to answer. The example that we have taken here is the example of methane CH4. For that, what we do is, first of all, we will write electronic configuration of carbon atom in the ground state. Ground state, we know electronic configuration 1s2, that is electronic configuration of helium. This is the one way to represent electronic configuration. So helium 2s2, 2p2. So there are 6 electrons in carbon. This is the ground state electronic configuration. In the excited state, if we excite, if we provide certain energy to carbon atom, this 2s electron will be gone. It will in excited, it will be it will go to one another 2p orbitals. Like we know 2p orbitals, they are all the p orbitals, not only 2p, 1p, 2p, 3p, 4p, 1p cannot be possible, sorry, 2p, 3p, all the three different p orbitals, there are 3 p orbitals, they are arranged along different axes, x, y, and z. If this orbital is aligned along x axis, we call it as the px orbital. If it is aligned along y axis, it is a py, and if it is aligned along z, we call it as a pz orbital. So in 2p2, we have not defined which is pxp, that is of not interest. They are equivalent, so you can call them any pxp, y, that's not a matter here. So I hope I'm not confusing you. Let me make it simple. Yeah, so the one electron from 2s goes to 2p. Now one can say all the electrons in p orbital, 2p orbital, they will be singly filled because of the Hund's rule that we know. The 3 electrons in 3 different p orbitals, let us call those orbitals as px, py, and pz. Now the in excited state, electronic configuration of carbon will be 2s1, valence shell electronic configuration 2px1, 2py1, 2pz1. So 3 unpaired p orbitals. These 3 unpaired p orbitals can overlap with the s orbital of 3 different hydrogen atoms. So there will be 3 covalent bond formation with the 3 2p orbitals. What we know in this one here is the different p orbitals, they are perpendicular to each other. So all the 3 bonds that are formed here should be perpendicular to each other, means at the 90 degree angle, means CH bonds, all the because of these 3 involvement of 3 2p orbitals should be at 90 degree angle. This is one thing that we will think because of the orbital of only pure atomic orbitals, overlap of pure atomic orbitals. One thing is the excitation, this excitation energy that you saw. I am saying that ground state to excited state means some energy is provided. This energy comes from the formation of the bond. In the formation of the bond, some energy is released, and that energy one can think as is compensated by that energy, the bond formation energy compensate the energy that we need to provide for the excitation. So compensation, initially you need to provide certain energy, and that energy after bond formation, some energy is released, that is compensated. It means that it doesn't mean that the bond energy, because bond forms later and the excitation needs to be done before the bond formation, so that it doesn't mean it will not go in the right way. So first excitation means you need to provide energy. That is why to happen chemical bond formation in laboratories, we sometimes heat or some kind of things we do usually to come over this energy, to overcome this energy, need of this energy. Sorry. So the 4 atomic orbitals of carbon, each with unpaired electron, can overlap with 1s orbitals of the 4 hydrogen atom, which are also singly occupied. These 4 orbitals are, you know, singly occupied, so they can overlap with 4 1s orbitals of four different hydrogen atoms. So these three bonds, however, the 3p orbitals of carbon are at 90 degree to one another. Therefore, 3 CH bonds should be oriented at 90 degree to one another. This is one would assume in this case. And the 2s orbitals of the carbon, we know 2s orbital is spherically symmetrical. So this the angle, the orientation of the fourth bond will not be ascertained because from any direction, the p orbital, this 2s orbital is there, 1s come and can form the bond. The 2s orbital of carbon and 1s orbital of hydrogen are spherically symmetrical and they can overlap in any direction. Therefore, the direction of fourth CH bond cannot be ascertained. So what we know experimentally that the CH-CH bond angle in methane is 109 degree, around 109 degree. And it CH4 takes tetrahedral symmetrical tetrahedral geometry. And here we are not getting with this explanation, means explanation based on the pure atomic orbitals. So the question comes is how will then we explain this kind of bond formation in methane or any other polyatomic molecule. So the concept of that is what I am saying, the concept of hybridization came. But before again the hybridization, let us understand two different types of covalent bonds that are known to us. These covalent bonds are sigma bond and pi bond. A sigma bond, they are because of different type of overlaps, a different type of overlaps that we saw here. This is the one type of overlap. And this is another type of overlap. Either in this type of, this is the nucleus, this is the nucleus, this overlap happens along the internuclear axis. And this overlap is not along this axis, but one overlap is above the internuclear axis, one is the below internuclear axis. So these two kind of overlaps we see here. This is one, this is the same type, this is called also called axial overlap, this is called sidewise overlap or the parallel overlap, sometimes people also say. Now we see the sigma bond, this type of covalent bond is formed when two half filled atomic orbitals of two different atoms overlap between the nuclei of two atoms. There are two atoms, their nuclei if overlap, this is called so-called the internuclear axis. These two nucleus, you join these two nucleus with certain line, we call it as an internuclear axis. And this is we call as sigma bond overlap. These are two nucleus and this valence shell, that these orbitals overlap with each other and they founded one this kind of shape. If this overlapping orbitals are SS orbitals, we call SS overlap. If the overlapping orbitals are S and P, this is SP overlap. If the PP, different PP orbitals, they overlap, we can call it as a PP overlap. This is a P orbital, this is P orbital, they are coming in the right orientation. And so these are PP, this is PP overlap. And one thing we can see here is that because of the color, we see this is not a in the right phase, that is a different thing to understand. If they are with the same color, the color is shown with the phase, but there this kind of overlap happens, there will be no bond formation. But just to understand what is the PP kind of overlap, this is okay. This figure is okay for us. So in sigma bond, the orbital axis is parallel to the internuclear axis. This is one thing, the orbital axis, this is orbital. This is P orbital, dumbbell shape, and this orbital, this axis is parallel to this internuclear axis. You see here, this is orbital axis and the internuclear axis is also along this direction. So this orbital axis is parallel to the internuclear axis in the sigma bond formation. This is one thing to remember. This can be formed, the sigma bond can be formed by any of the following type of combination of atomic orbitals. That is what I have explained. SS overlap, SP overlap, PP overlap. It is not only this kind of overlap can only form the sigma bond. D orbitals overlap, S and D, P and D overlap. If this is also coming in this fashion, they can also form a sigma bond. Now the pi bond occurs when two atomic orbitals of two different atoms overlap outside of the internuclear axis, outside of this internuclear axis, not in the on the internuclear axis. Overlap doesn't occur here. that is in the formation of pi bond atomic orbital overlap in such a way that their axis remains parallel to each other and perpendicular to the internuclear axis. The orbitals formed due to sidewise overlap is also called sidewise overlap. Overlapping consists of two saucer type of charge cloud above and below the plane. This is important point to be noted. This is saucer. This is like a plate cup type of electron cloud it forms above the this plane. The plane, if you draw a plane between internuclear axis, that is along this internuclear axis, perpendicular plane along this bond. So you will find that there is a two saucer shape kind of electron cloud here in the pi bonds. In the sigma bonds, we show it doesn't happen. We know the electron cloud is very maximum between the two nuclei here. In this case, what we see here is electron density is not between two nuclei. Electron density is not between two nuclei. What does it mean? So these nuclei will repel each other with certain force. And when electron comes, this repulsion between two nuclei is compensated to a certain distance, to certain extent. So that is why the sigma bonds are stronger than pi bonds. And because of this internuclear repulsion is minimized in sigma bonds, so that overlap is also larger because these two nuclei come closer. Because with the distance, the repulsion or attraction, any kind of things increases. Electrostatic force formula, we know it depends on the R and this is reciprocal to R. If the distance is smaller, the attraction or repulsion will be larger. So if the nuclei are there, same charge, if they are closer, there should be more repulsion. But those repulsions are minimized by electrons when in the sigma bonds, and that thing is not there in the case of the pi bond. Now the strength, we just would compare strength of sigma and pi bonds. One thing just I have explained, the strength of sigma bond depends upon the extent of extent of overlapping. The overlapping of orbital takes place to a larger extent in the case of sigma bond that I have explained than that of the pi bond. There is weaker overlap. This you can see because of the orientation. Also, overlap is smaller here, and that is because the repulsion is larger, and hence the sigma bond is stronger as compared to the pi bond. This is very important thing to remember. Sigma bonds are always stronger than the pi bonds when it occurs between same type of atom. This is one thing to be noted here. You cannot compare the sigma bond between two different atoms with the pi bond between two entirely different kind of atoms. That is not a fair comparison. If the sigma bond forms between, suppose, two carbon atoms, then you can compare the sigma bond with the pi bond in this between the same carbon atoms. You cannot compare the sigma bond between hydrogen and pi bond between carbon and carbon. This kind of comparison are not fair. The first bond formed between two atoms is always sigma bond. This is one thing. The first bond is always sigma bond. This is to be remembered. In the formation of multiple bonds between two atoms, pi bonds is formed in addition to a sigma bond. Why this is? Because first bond is always sigma bond. Even after that, whenever the next bond comes, the other two bonds, they are always pi bonds. And those bonds occur because of the sidewise overlap of atomic orbitals. So some important points about atomic orbitals that we just will note here. The strongest bond forms with the maximum overlap between orbitals. Greater overlap, less bond length. Smaller bond length, greater overlap, smaller bond length, more bond energy and more stability. So overlap is associated directly associated with the stability of the bond on the bond energy. Larger overlap means smaller bond length, more bond energy and stabler the molecule or stabilize the bond. The extent of overlapping depends upon, this is an important thing, nature of orbitals involved in the overlapping, the which type of orbitals are overlapping with each other, their nature, and another thing is the energy match and size match of orbitals. Means what is the difference between the energy difference between the two overlapping orbitals, and also what is the difference in their size, that also matters. And the nature of overlap. For example, if we see the example in our last class, we saw HF, HCl, HBr, HI. What we know that the size mismatch will be larger in case of HI. That is one another explanation. Two explanation we saw on that day. The larger mismatch in the size means the HI bond length will be bond length will be larger because this is weaker overlap there. So bond energy is weaker in that case, in the case of HI. Then similarly, the mismatch, because the as we go down the group, the size, atomic size increases. Similarly, the orbital size will be increasing. And in such a case, the hydrogen is the same. The first atom, very small size of 1s orbital. So the orbital mismatch happens, and this mismatch also tells why HI bond is weakest in case of HF, HBr, HCl, HBr, and HI. And that trend we know, the strength of acidity in case of that hydrides of halogen atoms. And then the nature of overlap. Nature of overlap means the overlap is axial overlap or the parallel or sidewise overlap. Means the sigma bond or pi bond. The nature of orbitals involved, you know, these orbitals are p orbital or s orbital or they are hybrid orbitals. So this also depends on this. So there are three points that we need to remember, which actually explains the extent of overlap means, and so the strength of a bond. Nature of orbitals, energy match or size match, energy and size will actually go similar, that we will explain later. Nature of overlap, usually more closer the valence shell to the nucleus, more will be the overlapping, and hence the bond energy will be high. More closer valence shells, this is one thing. R to the nucleus means the smaller the size of the atom, more will be overlapping. In such a case, more overlapping happens, and hence the bond energy will be high. This is one thing we can remember. So s orbitals are spherically symmetrical, and thus only head on overlapping. Because of the overlapping, say this spherical symmetry of s orbitals, we always see head on overlapping means always s orbitals will always form sigma bonds. This is it means this s orbitals always form sigma bonds. This is because of their spherical symmetry. P orbitals are directionally concentrated and thus show either head on overlapping sigma bond or lateral overlapping, that's the pi bond. So p orbitals, what we know here from here is that it can form sigma as well as pi bonds, and we have seen earlier in those figures that p orbitals, they can form sigma bonds, they can have head on overlap, or they can have a lateral overlap, that's a pi bond that we saw, depending on their orientation. Similar to p orbitals, d orbitals may also form both sigma and pi bonds depending upon their orientation. And this kind of, you know, sigma bond formation that involves d orbitals, this usually happens in transition metal complexes. Though you must remember that d orbitals can also form sigma and pi bonds. And that is why that when the ligand comes, depends on the ligand, some certain ligand when comes, they form both pi and sigma bonds. That is called bonding and back bonding, back donation, donation, back donation, and those kind of things like carbonyl CO molecules, carbon monoxide forms certain kind of bonds with transition metals, that there we see sigma and pi bond formation between d and p orbitals. P orbitals, there's a bonding and antibonding orbitals will be in the case of carbon monoxide that you will see, and it was explained by Dewar, Chet, and Duncanson. That's the theory that you will see later in that transition metal chemistry. Now just a comparison between sigma and pi bond that we have already shown there, just it is listed here. Just we will see one by one. Sigma bond results from the end to end overlapping. End to end overlapping, that you know, this is end to end overlapping of two s orbitals or two p orbitals or one s and one p orbitals. That is ss, sp or pp, this kind of overlap. While pi bond results from the sidewise or lateral overlapping of two p orbitals. Lateral overlapping, it is not shown here. Here this is shown. This is lateral overlapping. Because of the lateral overlapping, it forms p and d orbitals, and usually p and d orbitals are also involved in lateral overlapping. You know, see, this is lateral overlapping p and d orbitals. This is with the same phase overlap here. You know, this positive and negative overlap, and the orientation is right. If the orientation is different, if suppose this bond you rotate in the plane up, this okay, so actually I am not visible right now, so I cannot show with my hand. So if you rotate it in this direction, certain in out of the plane of this laptop, so orientation will be different. In such a case, there will be no overlap, so there will be no bond formation. And this is that, so this kind of overlap is called p pi d pi overlap, and this kind of back bonding we see certain cases. We also see p pi bonding, back bonding. We will see later on when we'll study group chemistry, and p pi d pi back bonding or bonding we see in transition metals and also in the main group chemistry at certain places in case of heavy atoms. And d pi overlap, d pi, you know, two d orbitals overlap with each other. So we say this is pi bond formation. It doesn't mean pi bond formation happens. D orbitals forms only pi bonds. D orbitals also form sigma bonds, and that it forms with the dz square and dx square, dy square. Suppose this is py, and if we have this is py, if we have a d orbital with dx square, dy square, so yy will overlap in that line, this line. If this dz square, suppose this orbital is dz, so another dz square of the will come, because you know, d 5d orbitals are dx square, dxy, dyz, dzx, so this is kind of dxy, dy, and other we can say and then dx square minus y square and dz square. These are 5d orbitals. So depending on which orbital is overlapping with p orbital, we can say the bond is sigma or pi. This is because it depends on the orientation, the overlap. The sigma bonds are strong, pi bonds are weak. Sigma bonds are less reactive, means because of the stability, it is stable. Molecule is stable in such a case, so it is we need more energy, need to provide more energy to break the sigma bond. So in the case of chemical reaction, what happens? A certain bonds break and a new bond formation happens. This is a chemical reaction, the bond breaking and bond formation. So to break the sigma bond, we need to provide more energy, because the sigma bonds are more stable than pi bonds. So sigma bond molecules with the sigma bonds are less reactive, and molecules with the pi bonds are more reactive. We'll see in organic chemistry, lot of chemistry involving alkene and alkyne. And sigma bonds, electron clouds are symmetrical about the internuclear axis. Internuclear axis, what does it mean? Is a symmetrical arrangement is this. It's a symmetrical arrangement around long internuclear axis, but in case of pi bond, it is not internuclear axis. The electron cloud is concentrated at certain area in the saucer shape, and so electron cloud pi bond, electron cloud are symmetrical above and below the plane. That is the symmetry. If you find a plane or line between along the internuclear axis, then you can say it is symmetrical. Otherwise, it is not a perfectly symmetrical along internuclear axis. Okay, so independent sigma bond can exist independently, means you can have one bond and that bond will be sigma bond only. You cannot have a single bond with the pi kind of overlap. It will not happen. So sigma bonds, free rotation is possible. Free rotation, you know, there is only one bond between two atoms, so you can easily rotate it around this, and so that electron cloud will remain the same, because electron cloud along the internuclear axis is symmetrical, that we have just studied. It is symmetrical, so you rotate this bond, there will be no change in electron cloud, so bond is the same. But in the case of pi bond, when you will rotate this molecule, you will have to rotate this molecule, you will have to break the pi bond, because this pi bond, if you rotate it along this line, it means the pi bond will break first. And because of the nature of the electron cloud, and because electron here cloud symmetrical above and below plane, above and below plane it is symmetrical, you just rotate it, the bond will, this overlap will break. So that no rotation, free rotation possible until you break the pi bond. Another way to understand this is like if you have to, it's okay. I think this is explained here because of this. If suppose like some people say that there is something, two things that is involved, like there are two strands and of like suppose two logs, and if you put something between one thing that took that connect these two logs, you can easily rotate one log. There's a practical example. But if you put two things, the connecting things like a strand of a staircase, so it will be difficult to rotate them because the free rotation is not possible because there are two bonds. It is connected at two different positions. The practical thing that people tell sometimes, like the Morrison Boyd, it explains there. Book or any chemistry book. The thing is, now no free rotation means there is a hindered rotation. Rotation is hindered or restricted along a pi bond. That is why certain molecules which are having pi bonds, they show geometrical isomerism that we will see when we will study isomerism. It means the free rotation is the significance here is it helps us to understand why certain molecules with pi bonds show geometrical isomerism, that one pi, one sigma bond, a double bond, like alkenes. Alkenes, all not all alkenes show geometrical isomerism, like ethene cannot show. Because we'll see it later, but if there is this two hydrogen atoms of ethene C, double bond C, and two hydrogen with each carbon, if you replace this one hydrogen with both the atoms with CLCl, then you will find two different orientation. That is called geometrical isomerism, trans and cis forms we'll see. And so this is because of the hindered rotation. You can recognize these molecules, and these molecules will have different chemical and physical properties that will be taught in isomerism. Now we saw the overlap, kind of overlap, sigma and pi overlap. The concept now that needs to be explained is the hybridization, because simple overlap of atomic orbitals, we cannot explain the shape of molecules. This is the, then the Pauli, in order to explain the shape of polyatomic molecules, Pauli introduced the concept of hybridization. What is the, according to him, according to the Pauli, but according to his theory, atomic orbitals combine to form new set of equivalent orbitals known as hybrid orbitals. He came with all the mathematical derivation of this. You please note that this, all the things that we have explained in the qualitative terms are based on solid mathematical derivations, solid theoretical background. Those are all mathematical derivations, and that is why these theories are very important. Though these theories are not perfect, they cannot explain some properties of molecules like valence bond theory and molecular orbital theory, but they have solid backing. So these theories are very important for us to understand. Unlike pure orbitals, the hybrid orbitals are used in bond formation. This is what Pauli proposed. Like it is not atomic orbitals that forms the bond. It is the hybrid orbital always which forms the bond. Atomic orbitals forms the bond. We will see only pi bonds are formed between pure atomic orbitals. All the sigma bonds, you just note here, all the sigma bonds are formed by the overlap of hybrid orbitals. So hybrid orbitals are used in bond formation. This phenomena is known as hybridization. Hybridization means what? The process of intermixing of atomic orbitals of nearly same energy. This is very important to note. These atomic orbitals should be of nearly same energy or slight difference in energy only. Then only the intermixing is possible, and resulting in formation of new atomic orbitals, same in number and identical in all respects. Same in number means suppose three atomic orbitals are intermixing with each other, so three hybrid orbitals will be formed. And before intermixing, these three atomic orbitals will have nearly same energy. They may not have the exactly same energy, but hybrid orbitals will always have exact same energy. And these hybrid orbitals now in the three-dimensional space, now their arrangement depends on the repulsion between different orbitals, and their orientation is not same as the orientation of the pure orbitals. So the atomic orbitals obtained after hybridization are known as hybrid atomic orbitals or hybrid orbitals. For example, when one 2s and three 2p orbitals of carbon hybridize in methane or any alkane, there is the formation of four new sp3 hybrid orbitals of the same energy and shape. This all the hybrid orbitals will have same shape, same energy, same size, and their number of hybrid orbitals will always be equal to the total number of atomic orbitals that were mixed before hybridization. Means one s here, 2s and 3 2p. So there are four orbitals that were mixing, so there will be formation of four hybrid orbitals, and 1s and 3p's, that is why we call this hybridization as sp3. If 1s orbital and 2p orbitals overlap, they mix with each other, then we call that hybridization as sp2 hybridization. So some salient features important of hybridization that is needs to be remembered. Orbitals of only central atom would undergo hybridization. We need to remember, because it helps us in understand the geometry or shape, because this hybridization concept has come to explain the shape of molecules, and shape of molecule always depends on the central atoms, the arrangement of different atoms around the central atom. So during hybridization, mixing of a number of orbital takes place. Number of atomic orbitals mixed together are always equal to the number of hybrid orbitals. The hybridized orbitals are always equivalent in energy and shape. We have seen all these things. Just to revise, the hybrid orbitals are scattered in a space and tend to be farthest apart in order to minimize repulsion between electron pairs. Just now I have explained, and helps determine the symmetry of molecules. Means all the different hybrid orbitals, they are arranged in or scattered in three-dimensional space in such a manner that if the electrons are being put in them, the repulsion between the electrons will be minimized. This is the concept of behind the scattering of the different orbitals or arrangement of these orbitals in three-dimensional space. Three-dimensional space, you should remember, it is not along any plane or anything. It's all around in the spherical volume. The arrangement of this orbital should be considered. Hybrid orbitals make stronger bonds than pure atomic orbitals. We'll see why hybrid orbitals make a stronger bond. Later on we'll see, but you just remember, hybrid orbitals make stronger bonds than the pure atomic orbitals. Hybrid orbitals form only sigma bonds. As I said earlier, it forms only sigma bond. Orbital sigma bonds or hybrid orbitals also can have a lone pair. It is not that only sigma bonds it will form. Hybrid orbitals can also have lone pairs. We will see later on some examples based on this. Orbitals involved in pi bond formation do not participate in hybridization. This is very important point to remember. I have also mentioned earlier, pi bond formation. In the pi bond formation, only pure atomic orbitals take part. Pure atomic orbitals, either p or d orbitals. Now, conditions for hybridization. There are few conditions that need to be fulfilled for the hybridization. The orbitals present in the valence shell of atoms are hybridized. Means the only valence shell orbitals are they take part in hybridization. It is not the core orbitals or the orbitals of the core electrons that they not take part in the hybridization. Orbitals undergo hybridization should have almost equal energy. Almost equal energy doesn't mean exactly same energy. They have comparable energy. They should have. Promotion of electrons is not essential condition prior to hybridization. As I explained earlier in explaining that the overlap of pure atomic orbitals in CH4, that means the excitation happens, electron from one orbital to other orbital. But this promotion of electron is not essential for the hybridization. This is why, as here I said, the hybrid orbitals also contain lone pairs. It contains sigma bond pairs, and it also can contain the lone pair of electrons. If that excitation of lone happens, or excitation of all the electrons or paired electrons happens, will not have lone pairs. So this is important point. The promotion of electron is not essential condition. Some electrons may be promoted, some may not be promoted. It is not necessary that only half filled orbitals participate in hybridization. This is another thing. Half filled orbitals, full filled orbitals can also take part in hybridization. That is why we see lone pairs in certain orbitals. In certain cases, even filled orbitals take part in hybridization. That we will see. But these are the points, that these are conditions we should remember, because we should not have any confusion. Now, the type of hybridization we see, first the sp hybridization. Sp hybridization means one s and one p orbital take part in hybridization. They come, they are of the similar energy, a similar, these orbitals are of the same atom, the valence shell of the same atom. They come here, they intermix. After intermixing, they form two sp orbitals. You see two sp orbitals, and because of the phase and all those mathematical detailed calculation you see here, you don't have to do those derivations. What you will see, this phase, you can see the shape of this orbital. One, its shape is at one side, it is enlarged, it is larger in size than this lobe. This lobe becomes larger, and one lobe that goes because of the out of phase overlap, this is positive and this is negative. So positive, and this is always positive. So positive, when they meet each other, there will be larger lobe, and the positive and negative, when they meet with each other, when they overlap, this kind of one thing, you will find various, that their magnitude will diminish. So that is why you find very small lobe with the negative sign. So this, a small lobe with the negative sign with a larger lobe with the positive sign is one sp orbital. Similarly, this negative lobe, a smaller negative lobe with the larger positive lobe, this positive lobe is another sp hybridized orbital. So there are two sp hybridized orbital here, orbitals here. This is the BeCl2 example. So this atomic orbitals of beryllium, we know electronic configuration of beryllium, 1s2, 2s2. So after excitation, 2s2, this electron goes to 1 2p orbital. So excited electron state electronic configuration will be 2s1, 2p1. So s, 2s and 2p orbitals of beryllium, they undergo hybridization. They form two sp hybridized orbitals. These sp hybridized orbitals are arranged in three-dimensional plane so that the repulsion between them will be minimum, and that minimum, because of that, they get 180 degree angle. The angle between them is 180 degree. And you see here, and now the chlorine comes. Chlorine comes with its p orbital, and p orbital, that one unpaired with unpaired electron, and it comes, it binds here, overlap here, another chlorine come with the another direction, and that is why you see the bond angle is 180 degree in BeCl2 because of the sp2 hybridization. These are all the points, let's see all the details how you achieve this. And another point is 1s and 1p orbital overlap, they intermix with each other, so hybrid orbital will have 50% s character. This is one thing to remember. Such a molecule in which central atom is sp hybridized possesses linear geometry. This is linear geometry. You see here, all the atoms are in one line. That is called linear geometry. This type of hybridization, means sp hybridization, is also known as diagonal hybridization. The two sp hybrids point in opposite direction along the z-axis with project positive lobes and very small negative lobes, that I have explained. Positive lobe, very small negative lobe, a small lobe because of the out of phase overlap, positive lobe, larger lobe because of the in phase overlap. That comes from the theory, just to explain it in the qualitative term. I have said it. One thing, the orientation should be right. This is a z, just only pz orbital is taken, but it depends. If you take x px orbital, that is also, it doesn't matter in this case, but in such a case, the two chlorine atoms should come with along the x direction. If it is a px orbital, so px orbital, then the px of chlorine will only overlap with that. Now the sp2 hybridization, we see sp2 means 1s and 2p orbitals overlap with intermix with each other to form a hybrid sp2 hybrid orbitals. Like we see here, this is one s orbital, the spherical vertically shaped of central atom, and this is one p orbital. You know, this p orbital dumbbell shape, another p orbital is along z axis, and one p orbital is along x axis here. So one is py, and it should be px and pz here. It's a mistake. And such examples are that there is a mixing of one s and two p orbitals. Three equivalent sp2 hybrid orbitals are formed because of this overlap. They were different orbitals. Now three equivalent sp3 hybrid orbitals are formed. Three equivalent on all these orbitals. Like, see this positive lobe, it has a small negative lobe is here. This positive lobe, it's a smaller negative lobe is here. So these three sp2 hybrid orbitals are arranged in this plane, three-dimensional plane, in such a way that the repulsion between them is minimized. That is why they are arranged in a plane, and in a plane with 120 degree angle. That is why if you find a bond angle in BCl3 boron, you know its atomic number is 5 with the ground state electronic configuration. The valence shell configuration will be 2s2 2p1. After excitation, this 1s electron goes to another 2p. So it will be 2s1, 2py1, and 2pz1, like anything. And the three, and because the axis concept of axis, you know, it's a hypothetical concept, it's a convention. You can take any direction as x and then perpendicular in another direction as y, another as z. So that's which is px, py, that naming is not important. You can write this as px and pz, or px, py, of like PYPZ is already here, so that this doesn't matter. And I just wanted to tell it here. So the three hybrid orbitals are oriented in a trigonal planar arrangement. This is the planar arrangement, the triangle it forms. This is called trigonal planar arrangement, and overlap with 2p orbitals of chlorine to form three BCl bonds. You know, these three Cl atoms comes and overlap with these three sp2 hybrid orbitals, and that is why we see this angle as 120 degree in BCl3, and it explains and why BCl3 has a trigonal planar geometry, because these three sp orbitals attain certain angle to have a minimal repulsion between them when the electrons comes in them, because empty orbitals will have no repulsion, only electrons. Once electrons are filled in them, then the repulsion will start. Now the sp3 hybridization means one s and three p orbitals, they take part in hybridization to form four sp3 hybrid orbitals. The four sp3 hybrid orbitals we see here, there will be some negative lobe, so, but because of this, because all the three dimensional thing we have to show in two dimensions, that negative lobes are not shown here. So a smaller negative lobe will be there. These four atomic orbitals, they will, we need to arrange them in such a way that there will be minimum overlap, and the three dimensional arrangement should be in the three dimension, and that comes only when they form a tetrahedral geometry, or they take a tetrahedral shape. So tetrahedral shape, it means you can see here that three dimensions, this certain angle they comes, and they are not in one plane. All the orbitals, this is along, you can see along one axis. If you see, these orbitals are at different angle. They'll take all their, if you write their coordinate, they will be on x, y, and z. Some point, these points will have a certain contribution along all the x axis. If this is, suppose, y-axis, so it will have only y-coordinate, x and z-coordinate will be zero. And in these cases, x, y, and z-coordinates will be certain value will be there. Now, and then in the hydrogen, this is CH4. So hydrogen will come, 1s orbital of hydrogen, and it will overlap with four sp3 hybrid orbitals. For all the four hydrogen atoms at four different 109.5 degree angle they come, and thus CH4 has a tetrahedral geometry with HCH angle, all the HCH angle with 109 degree. Now the same kind of sp3 hybridization can happen in the ammonia, case of ammonia. Ammonia central atom is nitrogen, and if we see its electronic configuration, it will be the valence shell only altered 2s2 and 2p3. 2s2, 2p3. So one a filled s orbital and three unfilled, partially filled p orbitals. They take part in hybridization. They form four sp3 hybrid orbitals, in which one hybrid orbital is already filled with two electrons. That is a lone pair. That those electrons come with the s orbital that we have seen, and the three unfilled orbitals, like the empty orbitals, they are arranged now. It should take all these four hybrid orbitals, a tetrahedral geometry, and these empty orbitals, like singly filled, not empty, these are singly filled orbitals or partially filled orbitals or hybrid orbitals. In that hydrogen comes, one hydrogen, and so there will be three bonds are formed between them. And thus, see, this is the lone pair of the same atom. You don't recognize them. You recognize the molecular shape in the terms of bonding. So NH, 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 what kind of shape it takes, that is called pyramidal shape. Because the lone pair, you see, because of these bonds are at certain angle, NH, NH bonds, they are like, they forms like a pyramid. You know how a pyramid looks like. Now, in the case of water, now again, the example, water. Again, oxygen has four valence shell electrons. The electronic valence shell electronic configuration of oxygen, central oxygen will be 2s2 and 2p2. 2p2 means 2p electrons will be in two different p orbitals. After mixing, means for the hybridization, 2s and 3 2p orbitals, they mix with each other, and after mixing, four sp3 hybridized orbitals will be formed, and out of them two hybrid orbitals take two lone pairs. Means there were four electrons in the valence shell. Those were those four electrons goes to two different hybrid orbitals, and now that there are two only singly filled orbitals now, and there will be the bond formation between them. So there are some examples here. This is ethane of sp3 hybridization. Ethane, the carbon, the four sp3 hybrid orbitals are arranged in tetrahedral plane. The three and one in such a way that one hybrid sp3 hybrid orbital of carbon overlaps with one sp3 hybrid orbital of another carbon. So there will be sigma bond formation between them, and the sigma bond formation here as well, one sp3 orbital of all the other three sp3 hybrid orbitals of one carbon overlap with the three 1s orbital of three hydrogen. And so that is also at the head-on overlap. So there will be three another sigma bonds. A similar thing happens here. So this is ethane molecules. Ethane molecules, C single bond, single. This is sigma bond, and there will be CH bond, three CH bond with the each carbon. Now in the case of ethene, if we see, ethene means CH, you know, C2H4. Ethene, in case of ethene, only one S and two P orbitals of carbon, they take part in hybridization. One P orbital is left apart, that is not touched, that doesn't take part in hybridization. So one S and two P orbital take part in hybridization. And after the hybridization, three sp2 hybrid orbitals are formed at both the carbon, and one sp2 hybrid orbitals make sigma bond between two carbons, and two other hybrid orbitals, you know, they overlap with 1s orbitals. Now there will be sigma bond, single sigma bond, these are all sigma bonds. Now the 2p orbitals that were of the carbon, they were having one electron, and so these orbitals so here I think I have made one mistake. Like the oxygen has six electrons in its valence shell. So for nitrogen, I explained 2s2, 2p3. For oxygen, it is 2s2, 2p4. I think I made a mistake. So this case, it is 2s2 and the four electrons in the valence shell, 2p2. So this 2p orbitals, the singly filled p orbitals, they also overlap in the have a lateral overlap or sidewise overlap. So they make pi bonds. So once the sigma bond is formed, these two atoms comes closer, and then thus because of this closeness, these p orbitals, they overlap in the sideways fashion, and so a single pi bond formation happens here. in such a the scenario, the octet, again the octet of all the atoms are fulfilled. This valence bond theory also explains to a certain extent the octet rule of Lewis. In certain case, whenever the octet rule is followed, but we know the octet rule is not a universal rule. It is violated by many, there are many numerous examples where octet rule is not followed. It is not strictly adhered by many molecules. So anyway, so sigma bond, and with the pi bond here we see C double bond C, one bond is sigma, one bond is pi, and we, this is, this explains the bonding in C2H4, that is ethene. Then we, in the case of acetylene, acetylene, one s and one p orbital of each carbon take part in hybridization, so two hybrid orbitals forms, sp2 hybrid orbitals at both the carbon forms. Then in such a case, two p orbitals in, but both the carbons are not taking part in hybridization, you should remember, because carbon has three 2p orbitals and only one 2p orbital is taking part in hybridization at both the carbons. So two 2p orbitals at both the carbon will be left over, and thus a sigma bond formation happens between the hybrid orbitals. And we saw here that the sigma bond formation always happens because of the hybrid orbitals. And the leftover p orbitals, those orbitals that were not taking part in hybridization, now they form a pi bond, here we see. And these hybrid orbitals, they are arranged in 3D space, 1 degree angle, 180 degree angle. You know this HCC angle is 180 degree, HCC angle is 180 degree, these kind of angles we know. This is 180 degree in this case. Here all this angle C, you can see CCH. CCH angle will be 120 degree because of this three sp2 hybrid orbitals, they take 120 degree angle in the trigonal planar kind of geometry. So that is why this molecule is planar. This molecule can say planar. This is a linear molecule, acetylene or ethylene. This is a linear molecule. The sigma bond formation, hydrogen comes, another sigma bond, and the two p orbitals at both the carbon that were left over, they, that were not, those who were not taking part in hybridization, they now come with the sidewise overlap. And these two orbitals, you should remember, they are perpendicular to each other because all the orbitals are perpendicular to each other. That is why this is 2px it is shown, and this is 2py, they are perpendicular to each other. So two pi bond formation happens, and these two pi bonds are perpendicular to each other. They are not along the same line. These pi bonds are perpendicular to each other. Now this kind of bonds you see, bond formation you see in the case of acetylene. This bond and this bond are, these two bonds are perpendicular to these bonds. So hybridization of elements involving d orbitals, we should also know that d orbitals also take part in hybridization. The elements present in the third period onwards, third period onwards means the third period, the n, the value of principal quantum number n will be 3. So with the 3, l value will be 0, 1 and 2, and by l is equal to 2 means d orbital. So only from the third period, means the from sodium, magnesium and that's onward, we find d orbitals there. Though all the elements which are in the third period of periodic table, we don't put electrons in d orbitals because they have all empty d orbitals. This is one thing that we have learned earlier. The energy of 3d orbitals are comparable to the energy of 3s and 3p orbitals. If I say 3d orbitals, it is comparable to 3s and 3p orbitals. We should also remember that the energy of 3d is also comparable to 4s and 4p orbitals, because 3d comes once you write the electronic configuration of different elements, you will find the 3d energy is between, after filling the electron 3d, it comes between 3p and 4s. Before filling the electron, 3d was away from the 4s. 4s was nearer to the nucleus. That is why we put electrons in 4s first. But after putting electrons, I mean, 3d is in between them. So that is why energy of 3d is comparable to both 3s, 3p, and that of 4s and 4p. If this 3d takes part in hybridization with 3c, 3s, and 3p, we write this kind of hybridization sp3d or sp3d2, sp3d3. But if 3d is mixing with 4s and 4p, the 3d is of n minus 1 shell, so we write d2sp3. This kind of hybridization you will see that we show. This is because the d is of n minus n shell. If d is of the same n shell, so we show d later in the hybridization. This is one notation we should remember. As a consequence, the hybridization involving 3s, 3p and 3d, or 3d, 4s and 4p is possible. However, since the difference in energy of these of 3p and 4s orbital is very significant, there is a large difference in energy, so 3p and 4s, they do not take part in hybridization with each other. Now we'll see different possible arrangement of hybridization possible with sp and d orbitals. This is called dsp2. As I say, d means n minus 1 orbital is d is of n minus 1 shell, and s and p are of the n shell or valence shell, and d is from the penultimate shell. That is called d plus s plus p 2p. p2 means 2p. These examples we see in transition metals. This nickel cyano complex, these are, and the platinum CCl4, PtCCl4 to minus. These are transition metal complexes. We know this is transition metal. Nickel is also transition metal. Trigonal bipyramidal, this kind of shapes. And this depends on the hybridization. sp3d. sp3d means all sp and d are of the same valence, same shell, means the n shell valence shell. That is why sp3d, 3p and 1d, 1s. Example you see pf5, pcl5. This is why, and you always see this kind of hybridization, sp3d. This kind of hybridization is generally feature of main group elements. Phosphorus is main group element, and this dsp kind of hybridization, it is a feature of transition metal elements. Now we'll see the formation of PCl5 molecule. PCl5 molecule of phosphorus, it's in the same group, it's just below nitrogen. So it will have 5 electrons in valence shell, 3s2 electrons, 3p3 electrons, and after in the ground state, in the excited state, to provide some energy, this electron is excited, is promoted to the 3d. This electron is promoted to 3d now. So now we'll have 5 empty orbitals. Now this 3s, 1 3s, 3p and 1 3d, these 5 orbitals, they take part in hybridization. We find sp3d hybridization here, you know, sp3d hybridization, and those 5 sp3d hybrid orbitals, they are arranged in a trigonal bipyramidal geometry here. So 3 orbitals are on the same plane, 3 sp3d orbitals are on the same plane at 120 degree angle. This plane is called equatorial plane. You should remember, this is equatorial plane. We call this in the equatorial plane, 3d orbitals are there, and 3 sp3d orbitals are just, they arrange axially, just perpendicular to this plane, one below, one above the plane. And we find a 5 chlorine comes in different along all the 5 directions to form sigma bond with the these 5 sp3 hybrid orbitals. You know, here these bonds are called equatorial bonds because these bonds are formed in the equatorial plane. These are equatorial bonds, these are axial bonds, this and these 2 bonds are axial bonds. One should remember, this is the 120 degree angle between all the equatorial bond and the axial bond. The angle is 180 degree, but the bond angle between axial and equatorial bond, you should remember, this is in 3 dimensions, this is a plane, this is 190 degree angle. Though it doesn't appear from this figure that it is 90 degree angle, but if you just imagine closing your eyes, you will find that this angle, this CL, P and CL, this angle is 90 degree. Again, this angle is 90 degree, this angle is 90 degree. Also all the, this, that is why the angle AB means axial bond and equatorial bond angle is 90 degree, and because of the smaller angle, there is repulsion, more repulsion between these bonded pairs. to minimize this repulsion, this bond length, this PCL bond to bond axial bonds, they get elongated. Because of these elongations, these bonds are weaker. The axial bonds in PCL5 are weaker. That is why PCL5 is chemically reactive. This is sometimes question comes, why PCL5 is chemically reactive? So it is reactive because the axial bonds are weaker than equatorial bonds. So it can, one can easily break in the chemical reaction these axial bonds. So it can, if just heat PCL5, will find PCL3 plus Cl2. Because of the heating, these two bonds break and you find PCL3 in there, that all the bonds in equatorial position and this Cl2 molecule. Now the another example is SF6. This is the last example. I'll stop here. So SF hydrogen, sulfur is the central atom. So hybridization will look at the only central atom. It has its electronic configuration is similar to that of oxygen. So it has 6 electrons in valence shell. 3s has 2 electrons and 3p has 4 electrons, and it has empty d orbitals, as I said, from third period onwards. So it has empty d orbitals, it was not filled. Now that once you excite these electrons in the excited state, these two electrons, one from 3s and one from 3p, they are promoted to 3d orbitals. So we'll have 6 empty valence orbitals in the excited state. These 6 empty orbitals, one 3s, 3p and 2 3d orbitals, they take part in hybridization, and thus they form 6 equivalent sp3d2 hybrid orbitals. 6 orbitals sp3d2 hybrid orbitals will be formed, and these hybrid orbitals are projected towards 6 corners of a rectangular octahedron. Octahedron, how to remember? You just write these bonds. Draw a square, at the center of a square is one above the one, put one point and one point below that square, in the line joining that square. In 3D space you find the octahedron, and so these orbitals are arranged at the corner. These are corner octahedron shape. Is this octahedron, you can say, in 3D is this. So octahedron 1, 2, 3, so it will have 8 faces. And they are at the corner of octahedron. These are all corner of octahedron. These hybrid orbitals are arranged so that 6 fluorine comes along these lines and they form sigma bonds. So SF6, 6 sigma bonds are formed, and this is called regular octahedral geometry. One thing if one should remember, if there is one lone pair, if there is, in this case, suppose some kind of bond formation in octahedral geometry, then you'll see it is a distorted octahedral, because you will have this square thing and there is only one atom here. The lone pair is of the sulfur, or any atom, the central atom, which may not be the example is of sulfur, maybe some SA, like in example of HEF6, if I say xenon hexafluoride. In such case, we find this kind of things, it happens. So this is the one thing, in if the geometry is this kind of tetrahedral, and if the lone pair has to come, lone pair will come to always equatorial position, because lone pair has a larger domain, and because of the larger domain, if it is the axial, it will be at the axial position, there will be more overlap. So in this trigonal pyramidal geometry, you should always remember lone pair always goes to the equatorial position, like I3 minus. If we see later on, we will see such examples. All the lone pairs will be at the equatorial position, because the angle between the lone pairs will be this, will be 120 degree angle, these hybrid orbitals, because lone pairs are also and the lone pairs also occupy hybrid orbitals. This is one thing we have seen. And thus, this is octahedral geometry. We'll stop here. Tomorrow we'll see the SCPR theory. I don't know whether I have explained it well or not, but it's okay. We'll see some questions.
Welcome to the Ramanujan app. In this video, we are going to demo JEE topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select mathematics as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the second subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Let us click the textbook icon again and select the second option. It will open up a message box, displaying the CEngage page number for that topic. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. Let's go with the first option. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the fifth icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from my IT pal. In this case, there are more than one video. Select any one of the links and watch the video.
Welcome to the second lecture on inverse trigonometric functions.
Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, straight lines, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook, that is, straight lines, which comes under coordinate geometry. So here we have textbook resource showing straight lines. Also, we have slide resource showing the slides for straight lines. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Now let us see the formula sheet for maths. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Physics Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the physics syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is GyanChat. GyanChat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Now let us click on the fourth icon, that is Gyan Moodle. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Let us click the textbook icon and select the second option. This will open up a message box, displaying the page number of the Kindle version of H.C. Verma book. On clicking OK, it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top, and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box, asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF, graphic and interactive content. In some cases, there will be video content. Let us select the text PDF content. Since this is an exemplar PDF from the NCERT site, it will ask your permission to download it from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will show the exemplar. Next, let's try the graphic content. It will load the graphical resource for that topic. Finally, the interactive content. It will load the interactive content for that topic. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Newton's first law. When you look at force, typically a force is itself defined using Newton's first law. A force is something that pushes or pulls an object and causes it to change direction, stop, change size or shape, or move faster or slower. Now, objects can be with no force. Typically, what happens is there is no alteration of either the speed at which the object is moving or the direction in which it is moving. If an object is moving, it changes direction, then too there is a force at play. Force is an external effort that happens to either a body or a system of bodies. It takes an external force to change the what is called the momentum. You already learned about vectors and scalars. Force is a vector and it has an effect on both the scalar value as well as the vector value associated with the body on which it acts. Now, there are two kinds of forces. There are forces that cause action at a distance, and then there are forces that happen because you are in touch, physical touch with the body. Now, but force in either case is external to the body that you are examining. So now let's state Newton's first law. An object remains in a state of rest or uniform velocity in a straight line unless it is acted upon by a force that causes that velocity to change. Thus, it takes a force to be applied to change either the direction, the speed, thus changing the velocity by either changing its speed or its direction. The natural tendency of a body to keep its current velocity is called inertia. When we say inertia, both the speed and the direction stay the same.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.